Good morning. I will try to explain you more about COVID-19, the COVID-22 related myths and few nature secrets too complex for American minds to understand. And I'm starting that being unpleasantly surprised by a milestone reached by American people. And my attention was triggered by a movie trying to debunk various myths about COVID for a nation sunk in alternate realities, and debunking myths might be the right professionalism. The people here, Dr. Morse and Dr. Madad, are both high specialists in the field. But debunking coronavirus misinformation made by an insider with these acting guest stars proves that they are how superficial the explanation is, childish, and that means the real level of knowledge of Americans they are addressing is so deplorable. And these Americans are so uneducated. Well, this presentation was triggered also by recent disastrous achievement of United States and a milestone in COVID business. Now, 10 million people are infected and contagious. That means 133 people you meet on the street are contagious, and that depends from place to place. 45 million, that means 1 in 7 American, was already infected and by COVID, and 1 in 10 of these, that means 4.5 million, is a long hauler, so has long time symptoms and has a bad health. Well, the most impressive is that we reached the amount of 800,000 people dead. That means 1 in every 400. And in case of a street, is about 1 person on the street, on each street, died from COVID or even more. And this is how they evolve. Now we have a wave, a second wave, a third wave, and a fourth wave. And meanwhile, nothing is learned. And if we took the lesson learned from China, we had only 10,000 people infected instead of 10 million, and about 800 dead, by 3 orders of magnitude less. Everything over is manslaughter. Well, in face of COVID-19, USA forgot the hierarchy of basic pandemic controls and lost the radar of common sense in protecting against any pandemic and controlling it. More, the issue become political, and our action in relation with COVID become a political statement, and unfortunately the COVID infection map resembles the political leaning map where more conservative people in the rural areas, with the exception of agglomerated places as California and New York, where applying protective measures is really difficult in the American context. So hierarchy of controls looks like a sound equalizer controls. You press the button, and how much you use a button up and down, you determine the how much the virus propagates and how soon you can eliminate the pandemic, take it under control. So this is a hierarchy. Hazard elimination, where you physically remove the hazard, is not true in case of viruses, because this is very difficult to achieve in a direct manner. Substitution, to replace a hazard with another one, less dangerous, is also not an alternative, because that will trigger us to make a mutation, or we did that by a kind of vaccination or by medication, where we replace a sickness hazard with the symptoms post-vaccination or medication. If there is no free lunch, is something as a collateral damage, but you need to do that correctly, the trade-off. And here is engineering control, administrative control, and personal protective equipment as the most at hand, effective, and cheap. And it gives protection before getting sick. So first, prevents you not to get infected. And here is how these controls look like from on this radar scheme. From 0 to 100%, you fix the importance, how much you are looking for breathing-related issues. Well, COVID is aerosolized transmission, and you need to pay attention to breathing and aerosols. The aerosols are floating for weeks, carrying COVID virioli, and you need to pay attention to air currents, and you need to filter them or to use mask and enhance the heating and cooling system, the harsh vacuum control system. You also have to consider they have some diffusion capabilities of skin through mask. Through contagious quarantine is a good measure. It's kind of an administrative control that reduces the encounters with contagious people. Make a test is good, because it gives you information if you need to quarantine or is contagious or exposed. Cell phone GPS Wi-Fi detection is a very effective measure, and it's not about privacy infringement, because the first condition to be served with a cellular phone communication, the town is to know who you are and where you are. And with this, you got another collateral parameters. Speed, acceleration, displacements, temperatures, sound level. So cell phone GPS will be now used in a good purpose to prevent for a guy who tested positive and goes into quarantine to get in advance the guys to quarantine and test, in order to eliminate from the society before becoming contagious. Boundaries control, that means borders, custom for passing infected people, but need to be done in a friendly manner. Administrative measures, social distancing, closing an economy, is a measure that may be taken in extreme, but if you use advanced PPE, you don't need to do that. You need to have enough hospital beds, intensive care unit beds, and you may increase your immunity by using various vitamins and alimentary supplements, but don't count on that to solve your COVID sickness issues. A healthy economy is something that is more fictitious. It cannot be done with sick people or dead people. So we need healthy people to have a healthy economy. freedoms, vaccine issues and wars of death are fictitious radar elements introduced by the United States population in the fight for so-called freedoms. They, in reality, they don't have, and they are just in their minds, because these freedoms and don't apply to dead or sick people. Vaccine is praised as a unique and ultimate protection, but is a wrong advertisement. You need first use this protection not to get infected, and only after you are infected, vaccine can do something. And worse of this is a component that may have or not a real value. Well, as the death rate is higher to all people that are retired on Social Security and Medicare, early death at 55 to 65 basically save about 1-2 million in the state budget for ever cost avoidance, but not making the medical expenses for the dead people. Looking to see how the result was happened, how the milestone of 700,000 American dead and counting was possible, we try to understand the level of IQ of the population of the planet, and try to see the difference of between the countries that solve the pandemic, keep it under control with difficulties, and the countries who excelled into pandemic casualties. And for example, we make a histogram of IQ, was also officially found on the web, and we find that United States was rated at 98 IQ number, while the Western Pacific countries, as China, Taiwan, Singapore, Hong Kong, and Korea, have New Zealand, Australia, have high IQ. But when we put the dependence and infection rate and the percentage per million people of rate of infection, we observe that total different image, and was how to say disturbing image. As you see in the map, United States, Brazil, Argentina, Spain and Italy and some other countries have a high IQ, and high they have high infection rate per 100,000 populations, that is reflected here in percentage. And we learn that these countries are not well prepared to face nation challenges, the human-made disasters, or the nature-made disasters. And we try to understand that finally the IQ was customized to keep Caucasian controlled countries and Caucasian population happy, fit excellent with ASEAN Pacific populations, but the other parts of the world are pretty with low IQ. Making the correction, IQ corrected to contagiousness level, or we introduced the infection rate in this logarithmic figure because of different factors. But we also consider the case of California, China, India, that have high density of population, that we need a density of population correction. So we have a correction at infections rate and density of population, and we bring that into the same range in order to see. If nothing will happen, then the IQ was a good value, both for the artificial knowledge and for the capability of population to face changes and disasters. Everything will be on the first B-sector and will translate from one to other in a linear manner. Well, it doesn't be so, and for this we divided the IQ and the countries here in four levels of intelligence, and we have a zone with ultra-low IQ, dumb countries, a zone with low IQ, moderate, dumb, a zone with moderate intelligent country, and a zone with high IQ or smart guys. And the same zones we put on the ordinate and say low IQ, ultra low IQ, low IQ, medium IQ, and high IQ. And when we looked at the final result, double corrections to infection rate and density of population, we observed that Macau, China, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore drop a little bit from the initial level to a little bit down. And that means them remain the ultra smart countries remain smart and make no changes. They didn't shift the position. But the disaster happened with IQ under 100 to 85, where USA is placed, which dropped significant from the mid-moderate IQ level into a dumb, ultra-dumb, low, ultra-low IQ range immediately. So when we put an equivalent, the same numbers of IQ, the failure was from 98 to 68. So this is a failure United States registered. And that is not a good sign because population is not able to face calamities from mainland disaster like wars and internal terrorists to natural changes like climate change or pandemics. The countries with moderate low IQ remain in their position, while the countries that have ultra-low IQ, the very dumb countries, rise to moderate IQ. So basically the population of the planet is in a zone of low IQ with few exceptions that are the Pacific, Western Pacific Rim countries and a few European countries like Switzerland, Japan. Japan is also in Pacific Rim, but all the rest are placed into the same level. So it is just a peak and with a tail into the smart countries. Well, putting that in other terms, in Gaussian, so in official IQ levels, we know that China has an IQ of 104.5 and a population of about 1,400 million people. So we draw a Gaussian because we don't know the real distribution of the Chinese population. And we put also United States, and we try to compare that into what happens. So when we make the modification to real IQ, China fails from 104 to 99, near 100, while United States falls from 98 down to 68. So the new IQ is formed by the so-called political tribalism that have Trump Republicans or GOT having an average IQ of 58. Republicans in name only has an 86, are smarter than Democrats have, are not as smart as these Republicans that Principia matters, and they have a standing, and they know what the values. And independents are the most smart of all population. But the very worrying factor is that if you put initially the IQ not change like that, we observe that there's a number of Chinese with IQ over 120, this area of the Goshen, is larger or about equal with the entire United States population. So this area is equal with the area under this Goshen or under this one. The problem is we do not have too many high IQ people that face the threat of the intelligent nation. And the only thing we can do is to move our IQ from where it is to about 135 in order to have a leading edge. Without this leading edge, that to be self-sustainable, we cannot maintain our world leader position. Well, many guys complain, well, COVID is nothing but a flu, and from the flu people are dying excessively. So we looked how the number of deaths and the infection in past from 2010 to 2020. And we learned that under Obama administration, the medical become better in treating the flu and less casualty happened, while during Trump administration, a destruction of a factor of 5 times and the improvement in Obama was possible, and in only 2 years they record, they got a record number of deaths of 60,000 people with a record number of hospitalization of 810,000 people. Well, while in 2020 when COVID appears, this number about a factor of magnitude higher, and Trump could be called the COVID king. Back to the video, debunking coronavirus information, they started with random myths for publicity, cleaning the fruits with bleach, school open because can't get COVID, all the falsehood they have put in various circumstances, and using highly qualified people that play the role explaining this, but the explanations are pretty low level. Now starting myth by myth, it was very disheartening to see how the guys believe in this myth and to appreciate the effort the people are doing to explain the myth. Well, as a result, surgical face masks could prevent transmission of human coronavirus and influenza viruses from symptomatic individuals. Well, the answer is true. It's a little bit too fluffy to understand why and how. And here is what happened. When you breathe, you shoot out particles, aerosols, that are small magnitude, and they have various dimensions depending of how you use your aerial tracts. It's basically aerodynamics. But without mask, you shoot them up to 10 feet, and directly the spit from one mouth goes to the face and in the inhalation of another person. If you have mask, as this speed stopper, or also called transparent mask, everything goes downwards on your chest and belly and doesn't go forward. So this is how the mask acts, and this causes a so-called community protection. So I protect the others in order that others to protect me. But that is something American doesn't understand, because they are very selfish and they don't give a crap on community protection. They need to protect themselves. And when it comes to this kind of protection, the mask acts like a filter. A filter is like a broom. It pushes the dust, but not all together. So if you look into depletion level of a filter, you observe that a mask N95 gives you about minus 13 decibels, and you calculate the protection factor by this formula. Then logarithm of number of the particles that pass through over the total number the particle entered, and here is a good example. But you also need to know that N99 gives a minus 20 decibels. It leaves 1 in 100 to pass. The problem is, a person in 1 minute, if it's contagious, is emitting about 100 million particles, down to 10 million, depend of contagiousness level. And there are various distributions of the particle dimensions. This is when speaking or breathing normally, and this is when coughing, when you shoot larger particles. And masks have different behaviors about various viruses, and that makes them difficult to use. When you look to the transmission from a mask to a mask, if this protects 1 in 100 at the exit, this doesn't protect in the same. It's just a 10% protection here, because what was filtered once cannot be filtered twice too efficiently. So repeating the same filter is not productive, and they are passing it. Here is an interesting calculation of how many virioles are inhaled. 27-30 virioli per cubic centimeter is a good number that makes you sick in less than 1 minute. This is when you have leaks at the mask and exhalation and then inhalation. The leaks in inhalation are smaller because the outside pressure pushes the mask on the face and reduces the holes nearby. But here you need time to understand, and this is the floating time of the virioli in air. So these small particles float in air for months. They are basically airborne. Only these large particles float for minutes to seconds, and the time here is about a few hours. They still stay in air, airborne. So if you exhale through a mask, all the exhalation remained airborne. Well, what American people do not understand is leaking in the masks. And you see here in image, there are a lot of experiments, but nobody cares about them. And when you exhale, the virioli remain in the building. So remain in suspension, waiting for another person to pass by and inhale into its plume. So the building has to deal with this and remove the plume and sterilize the air and have clean air all the time. Masks give a protection, but 5%, 1% pass through, so there is enough to put in air enough virioli that will go based on air currents infecting all the building. So buildings that have vortexes inside are not good, and you need to have the ventilation inside the building to approach the clean room concept. Is that is what CDC doesn't communicate with the population. didn't give them a clear explanation on how it behaves, in spite they know that for more than 50 years. Another spread area is a toilet, and when you use the toilet, you also put out a lot of COVID viruli in fecals and urine and from the skin on the toilet and surfaces. When you flush the toilet, you shoot a lot of aerosolized particle that collect viruli and makes spread all over in the toilet space. So the best procedure is to put the lid on, flush the toilet, put the lid up, and start leave and apply a UV light, a good power, 60 watt UV, for at least 15 minutes to kill all the aerosol content. In an office or a building, infected contagious people is breathing and gives this plume first at a high concentration of 10,000 per cubic centimeter, that goes a little bit up because has a higher buoyancy due to being warmer than the air around. It's about 100 Fahrenheit in an 80 Fahrenheit atmosphere. Then gets the same temperature and follows their currents, diffusing and increasing the volume while reducing the concentration. So it moves all over, and the person coming from the door in the office will be breathing into 1,000 viruli per cubic centimeter down to 100 viruli per cubic centimeter, but a high enough number as to get sick as soon as immersed into the air of one office with a contagious people. Well, these are very floppy, flimsy recommendations. Wash your hands. Of course, you need to wash your hands all the time, but skin acts like a filter. It's a protective barrier for the body. The transmission is mainly by aerosolized, and wear a mask, it's another filter to protect. But, you know, it protects mainly the community. This is a big improvement that the mask is giving. It just stops the speed to spread 10 feet and reduce it to half a feet. That gives attenuation in surface by 200 times and 4 to 10,000 times in volume. Contaminated volume is reduced for about a gallon instead of about a few cubic yards. Well, shall I tell American people that their solution, engineered solution for protecting in the pandemic control, that can give you a very high protection level and you can be very safe by adding supplementary all the protective together by combination of solution. So in triangle A, you have closed space protection made by improvement in HVAC that use down flow and chemical antibacteriologic filtration and UV light sterilization, and that is reducing and gives a protection of about minus 50 decibels. A collective protection given by the mask as a speed stopper and more as a collector and sterilization that can put the exhaled air down at the feet level. That brings another 50 decibels. Individual protection is based on filtration at inhalation, take the air from above, where it's less contaminated, sterilize and filter it and apply in the breathing, and that gives a 45 decibels in protection, while adding a supplementary duct and collecting in a sterilizer unit and flushing it out improves the properties of not spreading the exhaust air into the whole building and gives you better breathing properties. Each of them gives about minus 50 decibels, about here, and the risk is pretty low here and comes even lower if applied together. You get about minus 200 decibels, that means no virus transmission there. Well, talking to these populations about engineered protection, about aerosol propagation, is like talking to a herd of cows about wolf danger and making wolf awareness. And they don't care because one of them is dead, doesn't matter. They are more and they are happy that they are not dead and they so-called have herd immunity. And a herd leader is considering wolf as a hoax and does not believe what will happen next. The second myth is wearing a mask is dangerous because it will get carbon dioxide poisoning. Well, the explanation provided are good, but very superficial. Denying completely this myth is wrong because, you know, this is how the lung is operating. You have a residual capacity, a residual volume, and different volumes for this. And all together gives you the total volume of the respiration, how much you can inhale and exhale. And if you use a mask, you'll have a pressure drop on the mask depending on how fast you are inhaling or called flow rate. So at thermodynamics, you may apply this simple formula, pressure times volume equals molecular number times R, a constant, and temperature. Inhalation makes the pressure in the mouth equal atmospheric pressure minus the pressure drop. That is a function of flow rate. The CO2 in inhalation is about 500 ppm, while in exhalation a pressure is atmospheric pressure plus pressure drop on the mask, and the CO2 usually is 4.5. So you are inhaling at a lower pressure, so you get less air, and you are exhaling at a higher pressure, so you put out less air. That means you have air that you are not used, that is a remnant in the lung, in the total capacity, and this pressure, it's about 1% from the residual, and the carbon monoxide can go 2% higher inside the lungs. So that depends also on the mask, because the mask type gives you the pressure drop, and you make a compromise between the mask protection factor and the inhalation through the mask in order to prevent any leakage. In case of COVID, you need to do some measurements, and you need to measure carbon dioxide, and that's an oximeter, and the pulse rate. You need to have your pulse rate and EKG number, and you need to measure your blood pressure, systolic, diastolic, and pulse rate, and put them in a table a few times a day in order to track your dependence and your individual bioreads. So that computer analyst can detect in advance if you are sick or something happened in your system, because parameters of pulse rate and pressure are for sensors before the temperature to go high and observe something. Well, they showed the mask in the hospital, but look how sloppy they are. This medical staff is not at all protected against the threat they have to challenge, because virally passing through this mask, spread in the air, and they are inhaled by this nurse, and it will get sick. And statistics show that the infection rate is 1 to 4%. That's typically to a little bit better than masks N95 that are pretty bad dust masks. Well, another myth is all schools should reopen because kids cannot get COVID. What can be more wrong and more dangerous than this? And that was a falsehood promoted by CDC and the medical staff. I doubt the knowledge and the willingness to say the truth, and here is how statistics shows. It's false. All the kids start to get COVID, and we have a peak in COVID infections that come from more than 25% from the actual infectious rate. That was a horrible idea and a horrible political propaganda. And look how it happens. It is enough to have a single kid contagious, wearing a mask, not talking about Florida and Texas criminals that are fighting against the mask, but having a mask, it passes through, and it's enough virioli, so using a surgical mask, as all they do, it leaves only 10% out of the number of virioli exhaled, and this is enough. It's a number of about 10 million getting out from this girl. Not quite, maybe 5 million, because it has a smaller lungs and respiration, and that diffuses in air, reducing the concentration, follow all the pus, all the turbulence in the room, and goes in the nose of teacher or in the nose of other kids' educators. So this is how the transmission takes place, even if wearing a mask in a class. You do not have the room adapted for a downsized current and air sterilization at the classroom level or building level. Myth 4, asymptotic people aren't contagious, and that cannot be wrong, because it shows the great value of this virus as a bioweapon stays only in that, because you have an asymptotic population that spread the infection stealth without, in a seamless manner, without leaving symptoms. And after a while, when the propagation have been done and a large number have been infected, the virus system start to appear, the sickness appears, and death and hospitalization. And that is a feature of a bioweapon designed since 80s, and now was released accidentally or not, and manufactured or not is not clear yet. We need to learn the origins from China, from Fort Detrick, how it was released or how it propagates, but is a lot of talk on this subject, and it's not yet clear what happened in reality. young people, healthy people won't die from COVID, and that's another falsehood, because here are the cases, and here is the hospitalization percentage, and here is the death. So you have a high rate of death from for children in already registered in United States, and this is a very sad result. So publications were made in the scientific world, but nobody considers science, and some idiots consider science is politics, and politics is the science of politics. So there's no way to promote the truth in front of a guy who don't want to listen and use his brain to connect the dots. Well, another myth is that you cannot get COVID twice. And that is partially true. It's not quite a myth. It has some part in reality. In fact, if you had COVID and you paid the price, you have a type of COVID. And here is the distribution in the world of various COVID types and groups. And you see, United States is a melting pot of all the COVID, has almost all the combinations, while China has a single brand of COVID. But if you got COVID from a brand and you got it, you cannot get it the same brand, but COVID mutates because it spreads so much in the world, and it mutates more. If you have been vaccinated, you have a curve of immunity that is increasing from first vaccine to the second, and then is decreasing by forgetfulness process of the body. And the immune will be over-solicited if you will not forget about the virus and keep somewhere in the backup the memory. But the virus also mutates. So neither vaccine nor the sickness gives you a full absolute protection. And here is now a new mutant called Mu, because the guys hate the numbers and the standard typization, as I showed in previous slide, and like Greeks and Greek mythology characters. And that's different, and until you analyze and see how different is to tune the vaccines, it will be difficult to get protected against him. So the guys who had the alpha infection and the guys who got vaccine for alpha will be good clients for the new mutant. Another myth that was debunked there was you won't get the virus if you hold your breath in someone sneezes or coughs. Well, that's partially true, except you get variolic condensation on your skin, and also you need to keep it for very long and leave the area. So if you breathe in the next 30 seconds, the first sneeze plume, which will homogenize, dilute a little bit and be in a larger plume, will breathe in. So instead of taking 5,000 virioli per cubic centimeter, you'll breathe in to 2,000, and with a good mask, you'll still get 20 virioli per cubic centimeter, but you are inhaling about 4 liters, so you'll get about 10,000. That's good enough to get sick. Consuming disinfectants will kill the virus. Well, that was a stupidity. I cannot comment more and disagree more with that, but was a presidential advice. Cleaning your fruits and vegetables with bleach is effective? Yeah, well, they say to completely no, but the truth is not really. And when you use bleach or other chemicals, that will diffuse to the surface, and that will react with other conservants and the stuff the fruits are impregnated in order to stay fresh. Now the big deal, and that's unknown, is what kills you more, the bleach that diffused and you lead from in the crust, or the chemical used? What is more safe for you to ingest? Sometimes if you don't abuse the bleach and is effective enough to clean the conservative stuff, bleach, a little bit of bleach, chlorine will be okay, but that has to be based on knowledge, and that is not clear yet. And a safe way is to trust that chemical used as preservative are not as aggressive as bleach is. Warm weather will stop the coronavirus. Well, the arguments are pretty clear and good. We see the statistics, so we look at the milestone, and we'll see that this is not true, but has some truth in behind. When you talk about warm weather, you talk about more sun, and more sun outside brings ultraviolet figure, and this is what kills the virus. But the propagation is in the warm weather is doing inside, where the people try to stay and not exposed to the sun, and there the transmission is mainly made in hot summer days. Well, MS-11 is 99% of cases undangerous. The doctors here showed very clear that that is not true. And you see 10% of the COVID-infected people are long haulers. In the USA, we have about 5 million. These guys paid dearly after COVID, and after a year or two, they are not over and have headaches, dizziness, all the kind of heart complication, inflammation. I'm not going into detail, but it's obvious this is a wrong statement. The United States has one of the low mortality rate, was well debunked by the authors of the movie, and shows the United States in first place. But in the present, due to advances in medicine, we sit on the rank 20 after a lot of underdeveloped country. That's not an honor for us in any way. And we have 0.21% death rate, that means 1 in 450. That's a tragedy, it's a national tragedy, a national disaster. And these are the politicians. Look at the Congress, it's a Republican or a Democrat or something else. They are mainly incompetent and arrogant. And a search for D-troop in the causes of disaster was already done, but will be developed. 13 minutes is about 5G technology and spreading COVID-19, and the United States lost the competition in 5G, so they started to nick up Chinese companies, arresting highly officers in the company under pretense false accusation, as a Chinese citizen has to follow the United States laws. That is an aberration. And was a response from China in a reciprocity, and that was not good neither for Canada nor for the United States in the Huawei business and denigration. They don't try to use honest competitivity and try to do the other mean to block the development elsewhere. But electromagnetic signals can produce headache, tremor, dizziness, memory loss, loss of concentration, sleep disturbance. If they are exposed in a high quantity and the limits are for magnetic field about 40 millitesla, about 1,000 times an Earth's magnetic field, and the current induced in body is about 10 milliamperes per square meter. That is pretty low because above that, bioelectrical effects start to take a role and they have various consequences depending of where, when, and how the current is applied. Media is blowing the pandemic out of proportion. That is true in part, but media is basically a concentrator of bad facts. Now, in COVID, we have disinformation that generates this death, 550,000 deaths, and the COVID king was a terrible person, and did exactly what was not to do, and what was going against any reasonable advice, and have a bunch of lackeys and people with their character in a hateful broadcasting like Fox News that infected the cradle of watchers, the audience in Fox Cities, a lot of conspiracy theories and falsehood, politicians involved in promoting falsehoods and exciting about fake liberties in front of death, and also the new guys. So the incompetence of the old guys was replaced with the incompetence of the new guys. So a lot of false statement was delivered by the CDC, state and media, and was applied to innocent American people that were listening and unable to connect the dots due to the low IQ and perversity of their minds. And what is basically is this statement. They forgot the common sense. They made a false parameters to look for, and the ghost, like a ghost hunter radar, instead of watching and controlling the real parameters that can produce a change. And without this, pandemic propagating mainly in political boundaries, the attitude towards COVID was a political statement, and that was outrageous. They ignore another common sense in protection. Alara, Earth low, Earth reasonable, achievable. That doesn't mean you'll be fully protected. But if you work on time, so reduce the exposure time, you increase the distance to reduce the dose, or use shielding to do the dose, that will solve a lot of problems. And mainly, you will not get infected, and the COVID, instead going like that as a speed, you have just a speed suppressor and is going all around you, and from there will be moved in the building. So in an office with a lot of people, that is a real super spreader. Well, now vaccines were promoted as the ultimate and the only escape, only savior. And the reality in statistics looks like that, based on the newly released data. 1 in 15 is infected in the United States in the New York area. From this infected, 1 in 14 gets hospitalized, and from this hospitalized, 1 in 6 is dead. Now, if you put these figures in a healthy people and fully vaccinated versus not fully vaccinated, you'll realize that vaccine gives you a protection from 92% chances to 7.5 protection. That is about minus 11 decibels. That's a little less than N95. Another protection is to the hospitalization. Another 10 decibels appears of this ratio. And another protection is related to death. So finally, a vaccine barely gives you a minus 32 decibels. If you remember in the past, I showed you that engineering protection gives you high level up to 200 decibels. But the difference is, first, is not getting infected. This acts after you get infected, so it's complementary. It's good to have, but better don't rely on this. Only if you fail using the engineered protection, and if you fail using the engineered protection, you can rely on vaccine. But up to then, try to use engineered protection if you understand that, and you can connect the dots. If don't, doesn't matter. Vaccine is a very useful way to protect the herd. And they don't need to know anything about vaccine, not what's inside, as they don't know what's in ivermectin or in monoclonal antibody. They ingest in large volumes, and they'll get protected only after being exposed and infected. And here is how the protection is applied. This is the maximum you can get from a vaccine. And this is what you can get from engineered protection. Well, in engineered protection, you need to understand how a filter behaves in order to understand how well will be protected by a material or another and how you can use it. So, for example, any filter material has a cutting curve. So if it's N100, when it reaches 0.3 microns in particle magnitude, 99 particles are retained and one passes through. And when the particle dimension or particle magnitude decreases, more particles are passing through that at the virioli, COVID virioli dimension, almost 95% are passing through. Well, if you put a temperature variation, when you increase the temperature, the curve is moving a little bit down because it's a thermal expansion, it's another vaporization regime. And in liquid effluents, there are very strange effects happening. Some resonant filtration and some resonant atomization, where larger particles are retained but go around the fibers in the filter, and when exhalation takes place, they are atomized and supplied to small particle dimensions that makes the filter not being good also for larger dimensions. With the flow, if you increase the flow, because the pressure drop increases, more particles will pass, so the filtration factor will drop from, say, 99% to 90% if you triple or quadruple the flow. And a pulsed flow variation or a reverse flow and alternate flow will make the things worse, because the particle retained from one direction will be released when the air moves in the opposite direction and shakes the filtration membrane. So you need to consider all these effects into filters in order to get a good idea of how you can detect it. And the two main fact is, I'm politically independent, but the truth become anti-American. And when you dare to tell the truth in the United States, people stand against you instead of looking for the truth and connecting the dots. So this is what made the COVID disaster in the United States, and it was deserved by the Americans because of their low education and corrupted minds, mainly oriented in deceiving and imposture. So if the learning curve were used, and if you consider the differences in population, in China were 80,000 infections. So if we use the learning curve, we may expect at maximum 20,000 and stop the pandemic. In reality, under the King COVID ruling, that was an awful period, we get 28 million, and instead of getting 1,000 deaths, we get 500,000. And all this above 499,000 are simply manslaughtered. And this is what it have. And the real causes are 50 years of decay, bypassed education, politics, dominant, arrogant attitude, disrespect for science and truth. And maybe that is due to the disintegration of Soviet Union in 1990, the terrible impact of the United States that lost the compass. Now back to our IQ problem. You see, here is United States, and it has to move from 68 to 135, basically double the IQ of the entire population in about 20-30 years. That is impossible. As well, another solution would be that you have to have 2 million people, and with this IQ, the curve will become larger like that, and the tail will be longer than the Chinese. But even if we deploy the army, we cannot increase at this level the birth rate, and in 20 years will be impossible to move our IQ. Then it comes political tribalism and various species of IQ and populations are having various IQ, but they do not acknowledge and feel insulted if somebody will tell them, well, you have the truth, you are an alternative universe, you are disrespectful for realities. So among the smartest countries is Singapore, South Korea, China, Japan, Switzerland, India, and the EU are about here, and this will be a competition in the future of who will move the IQ, who will get the most attractive offers from shock and awe United States have using the idiots to send them to war and give them all or nothing after come back as casualties. To China that have the Silk Road that promotes cooperation and development under the umbrella of communism and other political influences. So world is a large competition, but India comes from the back and has good chances for development, and so the European Union is quite nearby. Population will give the trend and determine the history. Well, now we wonder why United States is a point of no return. And you look at the leaders, and you see it's a large diversity, but most of the people are vocative people with no real experience in science or engineers. Only 2 engineers is in the whole United States Parliament, and all the rest are formed mainly from lawyers that have no basic scientific knowledge, and from different factions as Republicans and Democrats, that looks like two guys on a motorcycle fighting each other while the motorcycle falls out of the cliff. And this is what you can explain by this structural composition is also a reflection of the basis. And this reflects the IQ population is tribalism. And when you compare to China, you'll get amazed of the high level of science in their members. Even they are communists, but they are scientific science persons with experience and credential. And you wonder, as long as China will be a smart dictatorship, will do what it has to do on time and at quality, and will have a fast development, seamless, and will go towards the first place. In the United States, we need first eliminate these guys from fighting and focusing on the real problems, and then to look how to move the IQ distribution from dotted red into green in order to have this edge of leadership over as a nation. So being a hub of intelligent and prosperous people is not easy. It's painful. You need to learn, you need to connect the dots, you need to use your brain for this stuff. And that is the most painful activity. So when you look at the actual proposal of President Biden, you will see that this is infrastructure investments. And we put in school buses, in water, in safety, in ports, but we put little money. 21 billion in environment is almost nothing. The same in the safety. Cybersecurity gets a little bit more around. Public transit is okay. And we have the social environment development where we put in health, labor, education only 726 billion for 10 years, that is about 70 billion per year, and we need about 10 times more, and only this little fraction will be used for moving the IQ, and that will be about 2,000 K per student, or more maybe the IQ with 10 numbers. So we'll get from 68 to 80. But being here with IQ is not enough. We need to be here and we need to do more. But unfortunately, even if we put more money here, we cannot spend them because we don't have the right infrastructure and the right knowledge, and we don't want to learn from others' lessons. Well, as a future prediction, you'll see how the IQ evolved from 1990 to 2010, and it was a decrease in USA in the IQ, as so happened in part in China, but the increase will be very shy. So that will place United States in the fourth place among world economies after China, European Union, and India, and they need to get used to this, because we are now in a point of no return, and Biden plan is subject to a big debate, but it's too little, too late, with a fuzzy address. So if we put more money in education, we'll do the same as we do in the healthcare, where we pay by 3-4 times more than any advanced countries, and that assured us a position between 30 and 40 in the world. So very low efficiency of converting. US dollar to knowledge, because all the base, most 90% of it, is educated into this spirit of learn and show, and not connect the dots and think independently. And that's the difference. This is what we need to do in order to keep the leading edge in the planet and be a real leader, a knowledgeable soft power with enough enforcing capability, but not putting the enforcing first and shock and door in order to promote damage and disaster, as we did in Middle Asia, but to promote development, technology, science, and welfare. And that must basically, at the end, if we don't go to destroy ourselves and the planet, to understand that we have to live into a multipolar world and to do our best. Well, thank you for your attention, and hope you understood something, and looking forward to your comments and observation. Thank you once again.